Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening. I'm Ida Lilly, and I'm the program coordinator for the Word of Storytelling Sanctuary. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, cool. So the Word is a nonprofit that fights for equity in publishing and literature, and you can learn more about us at thewordfordiversity.org. I'll also put some links in the comments. And this evening, we have a really fun event with one of our favorite partners, Duende District, aka Angela Maria Spring. You can follow us on our socials to stay up to date on all our wonderful free events. And we do a ton of them. Angela does a ton of them. So we are the link to all good things publishing and publishing diversely. And don't forget, you should buy the author's books from DuendeDistrict.com as well. As you have questions, feel free to send them in the comments and we'll answer them as we can. And Angela, I'll hand it over to you from here.
Thank you so much, Ida. Good evening, everyone. Thank you again to our wonderful friends at The Word. You know, I love you guys. We're so grateful to have the opportunity to partner with you for these past 2 years for this amazing virtual event series. And thank you to everyone for joining us. Again, I'm Angela Maria Spring, the owner of Duende District. So we are a collaborative pop-up bookstore by and for people of color, where all are welcome. And we are currently have pop-up boutiques in Washington, DC and Albuquerque, New Mexico. And for those of you who are new to our bookstore story, what I like to say is the cornerstone of the Duende Project is about the collective, the community, and creation and decolonization of literary spaces by and for people of color. So tonight's event, I'm so excited. It's basically the Central American poetry party of my dreams. And the only thing that would make it better, it is like, we are all like, this is all we've got, like, so much Central America represented tonight. It is amazing. we've got the Panama, we've got the El Salvador, it's the best. Anyway, the only thing that would make it better is if it was in person, but that's still gonna be rocking. We have two of the most chingona poets dropping verse on the stage and the page today, Melissa Lozada-Oliva and Yesika Salgado, here to celebrate Melissa's new bombastic verse novel, Dreaming of You, where she raises Selena from the dead and hijinks ensue. Melissa and Yesika are each going to perform some poetry, which I'm really excited about, and then they're going to be in conversation with each other. So, like I said, if you've got questions, go ahead and just put them in the chat and we'll try to get to them. Definitely let us know where you're tuning in from. You know, we want to hear from you as we're doing this as well, because you're part of our community. And then we'll have links to Melissa and Yesika's book in the chat. And then I also want to mention, we have a special partnership with Café Rebelde for a special curated gift box called Café con Libros, which features a copy of Dreaming of You. And we'll drop a link for that in the chat as well. So on to the main event. I love this book so much that I did something I've never done before, and I've been like a bookseller and a poet for many, many moons. but I wrote a poem review of Dreaming of You, which I sent to Melissa's wonderful team at Astra, and that led to this amazing event. So honestly, there's no better way to introduce this book than to just read it. So here is an ode to Melissa Lozada-Oliva's Dreaming of You. Dreaming of you is me, 17 years old, blasting bitty bitty boom boom through the parking lot of Albuquerque High in 1999. Dreaming of you is a line of lowriders bumping up, down to La Reina of Tejana Musica on Friday afternoons. Dreaming of you is me, a 20-something brown girl, former performance poet chasing acceptance and an MFA in New York City, dragging a white boy behind me. Melissa brought Selena back to life, brought all our zombie fame worship to light, brought me back with her, shone the spotlight on every mamacita karaoke queen wannabe. Dreaming of you is me, nearly 40, a Las Chismosas narrating this tale, gaudy fake jewel, heavy necklace of chisme, chasing ghosts and books. Dreaming of you is all what we all long to be, haunted and electric and lost, found and howling with laughter and terror, the Selena we try to shove down our throats to rebirth us as strangled songbirds. Si, queridos, we want it all too. And now it is my honor to introduce our guests. Melissa Lozada-Oliva is the child of Guatemalan and Colombian immigrants. She hosts the podcast Say More and is a member of the band Meli and the Specs. She holds an MFA in poetry from NYU, and her writing has been featured in Remezcla, Paper, The Guardian, The BreakBeat Poets Volume 4, Wirecutter, Vulture, Bustle, Glamour, The Huffington Post, Muzzle Magazine, The Poetry Project, Audible, and BBC Mundo. She is from Massachusetts and lives in New York City. And Yesika Salgado is a Los Angeles-based Salvadoran poet who writes about her family, her culture, her city, and her fat brown body. She has shared her work in venues and campuses throughout the country. Salgado is a two-time National Poetry Slam finalist and the recipient of the 2020 International Latino Book Award in Poetry. Her work has been featured in the Los Angeles Times, Teen Vogue, Univision, CNN, NPR, TEDx, and many digital platforms. She is an internationally recognized body positive activist and the writer of the column Suelta for Remezcla. Yesika is the author of bestsellers Corazón, Tesoro, and Hermosa, published with Not a Cult. So without further ado, these wonderful poets, take it away.
Hi, everybody. I'm Yesika, and this is my dear friend and phenomenal poet, Bruja, Melissa. Hi, Melissa.
Hi, Yesika.
You are glowing. You are the postpartum glow.
Oh, I know. Yes. Right. My baby is out. The second child, you know, trying to do better with her. I tweeted at you about this, but I had acrylics on for my book release.
Oh, no, you froze. She'll be right back. But she had acrylics on. I have
my back.
There you go. There you go. Yeah, you're back.
I don't know how you do that and are a writer. Like, how, that's like a superpower.
It is a mega superpower. And I'm so sorry if y'all hear weird noises. There are 2 5-year-olds having a war outside of my house. Like, I hear them. It's my next one, his best friend. And Mango found a squeaker toy. Mango's my dog. And he is honking it right outside of the window of the door. So, and everything was fine until we started talking. So just so you know, but I can't type if I don't have acrylics.
Oh, so you?
I'm so used to them that when I don't have them, I miss the mark and I hit the wrong letter.
What?
Yeah, because I taught myself. So cool. Yeah, I taught myself how to type with the ball of my. I could probably type faster if I didn't have them, but I've typed on my books with acrylics. But when I don't have them, I'll mess up, and instead of the K, I'll hit like the M or whatever, or I don't know.
That's prime chingona hot girl shit. Like, look at this. This is that's what I'm working with.
but you know what? It's like I'm not a high maintenance person. I just pull myself together for the events, because otherwise. Yeah. An hour before now, I looked like a whole different person.
Honestly, me too.
It's fine. It's like, you know, we can't keep the glam up when we're creating. Like, I feel like we look like, yeah. I look like so, like, I look like I'm losing my mind every time I'm working on a book.
Oh, no, me too. Yeah. Like, no bra. There's like ginger ale around me for some reason. It's disgusting. It's not glamorous.
And I chug so much coffee that I give myself panic attacks because, like,
I'm not drinking water. I know my eyes start to sink. Yeah. It's glamorous.
Like, oh, you look awful. You look awful. You must be working on a book. Yes, exactly.
You're like, yep, I haven't slept.
I haven't slept in 5 months. I'm going to read a couple of poems and then I'm going to give it away for you. So you guys, if y'all haven't read this book yet, you're failing at life, first of all. and also, if you want to give yourself an extra gift, what I did with your book was I listened to the audio while I read.
Whoa.
So I feel like I hung out with you for like an afternoon.
Yeah.
It was like really, I really loved it because, well, we'll talk about it a little bit more. So I'm going to read a couple of poems and then I'm going to hand it over for you to read from this beautiful, beautiful book. And like, I almost even don't want to read anything just because I want to hear you.
I want to hear you.
Can you ever realize, like, I mean, after reading your work, I was just like, I'm bored by all my stuff. Mine is so like normcom. Like, it just feels like it's too I don't know. And I'm like, I want some more of that, you know? And I used to have whatever life. Okay, this is called Ya Casi. And I'm reading from my most recent book, Hermosa, which was released in late 2019. And you could buy it at Duende. So please, if you all want to get a copy, do that there. Your parents say goodbye while they're all... It's called Ya Casi. Your parents say goodbye while they're still sitting at the dinner table. Then they stand with their keys in their hands and say it again. They move to the door and say it some more. Then the driveway. When the car turns on, your tío leans a hand on the window while they keep saying goodbye. Mommy forgets something and runs back inside. They all stand by the car some more. You fall asleep a little bit. You wake up and they're still there. You get back out of your car to play with your cousins. Papi calls you back in. Tio smacks the car one time. Tia waves, and you're leaving for real, finally. But you wish they had kept saying goodbye for a bit longer. When you grow up, and you are a full-blown adult in love, and love goes sour, you threaten to leave. You sit at the table and say, I am gone. Some days pass, and you stand with your keys in your hand. You swear you're going to do it. Weeks later, you make it to the door, say goodbye some more. Make it to the driveway, your lover leans in, promises the right things with one hand on your thigh. You linger, but you swear it's only for a little. Grow numb and forget about breaking up. It's like you fall asleep, settle into staying. You are all in again, but remember why you have to go. This time, it is real. Finally, you are gone. All right, and I'm going to read one more poem for you. And it's called, I'm still trying to decide which one it is. So I'm like, it's called Come to Me. Okay, it's called The Jacaranda Tree. And it's about, I've been thinking a lot about our own spaces and what it is to carve out your own space, not only to live in, but to create in and to love in and to exist in. And this is kind of, this was me manifesting a place of peace for myself after a really bad breakup. I just want my own place. Somewhere to burn sage. I want to play music loud, have it sweep the floors for me. I want mangoes and avocados on my table. Walls the color of ripe fruit. Couches soft as a lover's belly. I want to keep the door open. A small garden outside. A jacaranda tree just beyond the fence. I want to hear the highway in the distance. Mistake is roar for ocean. I want the ocean nearby. Mistake is whistle for a highway. I want windows with no blinds. Yawning into a night sky. Tear streaked on rainy afternoons. I want books on every surface. A kitchen that smells like coffee. Pots and plates that cling together, an oven full of skillets and pans, my niece and nephew's drawings on the fridge. I want a bear that was born a dog asleep beneath my desk. I want to call him something silly like baby or tiny. I want picture frames on all of the shelves, a phone ringing every afternoon with my mommy's voice, candles I light when I am joyful or melancholy, but most of all, I want to find a home that isn't you, that isn't us, that isn't that quiet room where we died, where I left all hope of you coming back, announcing that you chose me after all. Instead, I want my old place, and doesn't that sound so nice? And a last quick short one, because I have to read a horny poem, because Melissa and I were talking about being horny poets. This is called Sacrilegious, and I love this poem because it's the second poem in the book, and the second book ends naming a lot of biblical references and me taking them as things of empowerment for myself, where I'm saying, like, I'm Mary Magdalene, I'm Joseph, I'm God, I'm Jesus dead and resurrected, and then I use some quote some lines from that you use in Mass. And this poem is called Sacrilegious, and I use a lot of Catholic imagery. When I was 13, I wanted to be a nun. And I think it's my weirdest quirk that I was going to be a nun one day. But I play with that a lot. And a woman left a review on Amazon saying that she hopes I find God and that nobody should buy my book because I'm evil. And I love it. Sacrilegious. This is a church I built. There is no God here. I burn all the Bibles and hymns. All the statues lie on their backs, and I am dressed in the lace kept for altars. In this temple, there is no woman weeping at a man's feet. The apostles were sent off as to never return. The wine remains, and it is still blood, and I offer it to my lovers with manicured hands. Religion keeps folks warm at night, and the men in my bed know the creed of my bedroom, the sweet sacrament of thighs and mouth. There is only one choir here, one song, their moans, venerating my blessed flesh. Thank you. And now I'm going to hand it over to my beloved Melissa. And let's enjoy.
Thank you so much, Yesika. Yesika is such a magical writer, and I feel such a kinship with her because she, like me, is also so horny and also writes like love poems. And I think, I don't know, being in the bodies that we are, being Latinas, I think it's important to like reclaim sexuality and love. And I just am very inspired and appreciate everything you do. So here is a poem called What If Selena Taught Me How to Fake an Orgasm? Where did it go? Okay, oh my gosh, sorry, it went away. All right. What if Selena taught me how to fake an orgasm? If you were on top, she would say, make the sound an umbrella does when it's being opened up inside. If he's taking you from behind, turn into a branch with eyeballs for leaves. Blink. If his head is in between your legs, she would tell me, give birth to the scene in Armageddon when Ben Affleck uses Liv Tyler's body as a valley for his animal crackers. If you are in public, invite everyone you know. Bring masks you can slip on and off. Wear your tap dancing shoes. Wear a tall hat. Put something groovy on that won't make you want to cover your ears, jump up and down, and scream later when you hear it in the feminine products aisle at the CVS. Turn on the smoke machine. Now the stage lights pour through every orifice of your body. Now you are dripping with mirrors. Now there are flowers at your feet and rabbits scurrying around making more rabbits. The moment is here, she'd let me know. And by this time, she is proud of me. I will have trained for this. Everyone is in my head, including me. Listen to all of that applause crawling out of my own mouth. Okay. So where is this? I've been thinking, so like as horny as this book is, and you know, the autonomy that I want to show with this horny little book, I think a lot of my family is in this, and that's like complicated because I don't know, I'm nervous about them reading this. Anyway, there's also this Greek chorus guiding the book throughout the book of chismosas, and they're this like all-encompassing, you know, theas and spirits who just know everything that's going on. So this is them. Zombies are so totally out and basically a fear-mongering tool to get you to filter your water or not vaccinate your kids. We are not saying we don't trust the government. Not this time. This time we are saying, don't you ever feel like people would care about you more if you were dead? And this is a poem about my family. It is called, Just to Make Things Clear, I Am Not a Haunted Person. It's always my mom or my sisters who see women in gowns, standing over their beds, saying their name, who, when a glass breaks or a pair of pants rips, says, I had a dream about this. Who tell me of seeing Abuelita dance with skeletons and gravestones through our door and out the window, who know what the dogs, who know that the dogs need to take a shit just by the way their eyes look, who feel that there are cats sleeping underneath the porch just because of the way the wind dances outside, who kiss people and just get a certain feeling, who have a dream about their tights ripping and then the next day there's the tear, who believe that the dead aren't really dead, but whistling at them from the trees, who move through their lives following the trail of salt in front of them, trusting it will take them somewhere with sun. I've never felt leaves winking at me. I do not carry crystals in my pockets. I buy candles and forget to light them. I've let an iced coffee mold over my tarot deck. I record everything compulsively. I want to leave everything behind. And I'll read two more poems. And this one is called 6-5, looking for something casual that has the potential to be something more. And it's a Tinder. That's like a Tinder profile. Oh yeah, there's a winky face also there, which also always feels like someone has sexually assaulted me when I get like a in a dimly lit restaurant. Is this a date? Walking back to a car in a dark parking lot with a gun to my back. Is this a date? In the trunk of a car. Is this a date? In a room tied to a chair with one dangling light bulb. I actually would say I'm like an introverted extrovert. Locked in an attic dressed up as a doll with a bowl of water and a plate of food at my feet. Yeah, I don't know. I just have such a weird relationship with social media. In a submarine unaware of what day it is. I'm trying this cleanse. Have you heard of it? Chopped up into little pieces and dispersed into the ocean. Little fishes feeding on my hands. So do you have any siblings? I'm kind of going all over the place. But this poem is about more horny poems. It is called, hold on, where is it? Come on, little book. Do this for me. It's called Remember That Yolanda Was a Little Girl Once. It's about childhood masturbation, which is normal. Remember that Yolanda was a little girl once. She was staring out the window. She was playing tic-tac-toe. She was burning spiders with a magnifying glass. She was straddling a pillow at night. It was active sitting. It was imaginative resting. Closing her eyes, she was trying to think of the right things. The sweat on Mr. Martinez's mustache, the bulge in the next door neighbor's shorts. In the next room, her mother was crying about bills and about debt and about family far away. She was opening her eyes. She was thinking of the blonde hairs on Miss London's wrist, the golden cross, how it looks like someone took a glitter pen and drew it on there. The phrase, I believe in you. She was dreaming of tracing her fingers on that honey neck, of yanking whatever God had put there. She was rubbing the chain all over her own neck and face and that stage between her legs. She was feeling herself start to glow. Okay. Thank you so much.
No, thank you so much. Okay, bye everybody. No, I'm kidding. No, but the book. So when I read the first, so the premise of the book, for those of you that haven't read it, I'm gonna try not to ruin it for you. It's so good. Melissa resurrects Selena, right? Selena comes back. It's weird. It gets weird. And it just gets weird in a really good way. Yolanda's in the book too. And I love the weirdness of Yolanda. I love like how she's a person, like not just this villain in our lives. Because
yeah.
Okay, why Selena? I know you probably have been asked this a million of times, but like why Selena? Like why Selena? Someone that like she's very important to all of us, but she is also someone who has been portrayed in many, many different ways already, to the point where it's become a little like, you know, there's a series out there floating around that we all have opinions about. So like what made you take on something that is so loved and so protected, and folks get really angry when you mess with Selena? And so, like, what pushed you at risk?
I think the question itself, like, why Selena? Like, writing this, I was like, why am I so obsessed with her? And I feel like I wanted to, like, interrogate my obsession with her. I wanted to interrogate the, like, feeling of, like, giddiness that I felt whenever she was mentioned or when her songs came up. And I think, like, I mean, she was, like, one of these, like, first, like, pillars of representation for Latinas in the U.S., at least, when she made that, like, crossover into American music. And I think she just like changed the game, and then she died. And then I grew up under the umbrella of her. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, and I think that is, I don't know. She's just been this ghost in my life and this God in my life in a way. This book is like weirdly like Catholic, I think, even though it's like, you know, hedonist also, but Catholic and like a Central American Catholic, like the La Virgen de Guadalupe is in here. She's like someone I light a candle underneath. So I think, guess I hope that answers the question.
No, like, I mean, you know, we both grew up Catholic, right? So we've grown up with saints, right?
Yeah.
We've grown up with saints we venerate. Yeah, exactly. That are like, we didn't have heroes. We didn't have Marvel. We had St. Francis and St. Lucy's and like all these, like, you know, all these folks that were supposed to. It makes sense to think of Selena like a saint. I never thought of her like that. But like Santa Selena, you know?
Yeah.
Like having altars. Right. To her.
I mean, exactly. Like, no, her death makes her a saint. Yeah.
Yeah. And I love how you played with what we know of her, but also what you imagined of her, right? Like you filled in all those gaps, you know, like the ending without giving it away, like the imagined endings. Oh, that gutted me. Cause I was just like,
yeah.
She didn't get to like have a teenage daughter resent her, you know?
Exactly.
And what was like, okay. So there's a lot of Selena in the book, but there's also a lot of you in the book, right? Like you're the lead character. And I know that you said something about people getting upset over that.
They're just like,
you froze, but you look so beautiful frozen. Like your eyeliner. There you go, you're back.
Thank you. I'm frozen in time. I was writing just like personal poems, and then I was writing Selena poems, and it just felt too like weird to make somebody named like Meli. Phrase again?
Am I back? Yeah, you did. You're back. You're back down.
Okay. Anyway, yeah, so this is, I'm in this. I feel like it's like a Melissa avatar, you know, it's not really me. I never really did this. But like, you know, these love poems are like when I was falling in love, and like my family is in here, and like very like real experiences that I've had with like anxiety are in here. Like a lot of the supernatural stuff that I'm doing is that's like a metaphor for like my mental illness.
But also what people forget too is that this is poetry. Like poetry is hyperbole. Like, no, my heart is not a fist. You know what I mean? Like my
ribcage. Yeah. Exactly.
It's not a cathedral.
No, that's it. It's just like, yeah, poetry is an exaggeration. And as soon as you also like when you write poems about people, it stops being about them too. It starts like being about you, but then that separates from you. Like what you've written like morphs away from you like a baby, and like has like flesh and it breathes, and then it outlives you, but you are responsible for it still. Anyway, yeah.
These damn kids. Okay, so we met. Yeah, so you and I met online 2000.
You're online.
Ish. I think. Yeah. Remember when we used to message each other on Snapchat all the time?
Yeah, that was really cute.
Yeah, we used to like send each other hearts all the time on Snapchat and all that. And
yeah.
And it was around the time. It was around the time where there's always been Latinas in poetry, but there wasn't mm-hmm. as easy to find as they are now, right? So at the time,
yeah.
we were kind of like all just looking to latch on to each other. And this was around the time your videos were starting to make their way to Budding. You hadn't gotten super viral yet, but you were like on the cusp. Because I remember you had the poem about your panty falling in the middle of like somewhere where you were.
Oh yeah, the black thong underwear.
Yeah, so good. And then you've gone on from then on. You were on a team a year that I wasn't on a slam team. We both used to do competitive poetry. Some of us have won nationally. Others just took second place.
It's in the past.
It's in the past. But no, but you have you're an NPS, like you have a title.
Yeah. Oh my god. So
your team won. It was an amazing team. Y'all won. But that's kind of like what you blew up after that, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And then you had your first book that I think mm-hmm. is beautiful. And then now your second. Like, so did you have, and I know that all of us have our things that we would have done better, we would have done more of, or we would have done less of with our first books, but like, was the second book harder to do because of all the other stuff around like your first, like the first book, all the success and all the things that you would have done differently? I'm saying that because that's an experience that I had. My second book was so hard it was the second book. I didn't get any more passes, you know?
Yeah. Right. I felt the same. Cause like this book took a lot more time to write than Peluda. Peluda I wrote in like 9 months. Like I wrote mm-hmm. this book took 3 years. And I mean, some people take like 10 years to write a book, but 3 years is like a lot, a big chunk of like my 20s. And mm-hmm. it was hard, but also because I was like, I mean, I am dealing with like a lot of, like writing this book, I was like dealing with a lot of like weird questions I had about like fame within myself and like having fans and being seen and like how it feels very good. That attention feels very good. And then it gets like, then there's like a turning point where it gets scary. And it, the same goes for like love or sex. Like mm-hmm. those things can feel very good. And then very fast, they can like something, anything can make it turn so that it is like disturbing. So I wanted to, that's what I was like messing with in here. And that was hard. Cause I was like, I kept going back and forth to things being like scary and things feeling good. And yeah.
Well, that's in the book too. Like, because it feels like a commentary on that. On like what happens if you become this icon, right? Which is what Selena was, where people were like upset that you had brought her back, right? Like that the character had come, that she had been revived. Because she wasn't like Selena the way that she was remembered. And that's really cool that it was something that you were, you know, straddling. Like, y'all, like being a writer is, I'm surprised that we are functioning people in the world, because sometimes excavating these things for books, even if we're not writing like our deepest, darkest secrets, it's just the fact that we're like Frankensteins in a lab, right? And I love that this book feels like that.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I'm waiting for you to come back because you froze again. Everybody take a screenshot every time she freezes, and then we'll do a montage. You're back.
It's very meta. Writers are always like stitching, like, you know, walking thing that has a life. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, okay, so we were talking about being Catholic and then being horny poets, right? Do you think that you would be the horny poet that you are if you weren't, if you hadn't grown up Central American and Catholic?
Okay. Yesika, I've been thinking about this so much lately because people keep being like, this book is horny. And I like literally think it's because I grew up like with the fear of God and and also like being like a woman in like a Latin American family, Central American family, where you're like, the only education is like, you don't have sex. And also there's like shame around having sex, like the shame and the constraint like ended up making me like a very horny person. And now I write about it all the time.
I love it. You tweeted the other day that your mom was telling a story about an uncle whose face melted because he saw La Ciguanaba, and that you were like, no mom, it was a stroke.
Yeah.
You don't know how my mother
Oh,
it was your abuelita that told that story?
Yeah, and then my mom was like, mama, he had a stroke.
You don't know how many stories my mom traumatized me as a kid, saying that a lady fell asleep with her fan on and she woke up with her face like messed up. Like, that's how she said it, right? Not that I'm saying, but that she woke up with like half her face like not moving. And then like I was, because her fan, so don't fall asleep with your fan in your face. And then as an adult, I was just like, the poor woman had a stroke in her sleep.
Yeah. Yeah.
What were you saying?
The answer a lot of the time seems to be it was a stroke.
Yes. But I didn't know you had La Ciguanaba also in Honduras, right? That's where your family's from, right? Honduras?
Guatemala.
Guatemala. There we go. That's why. Guatemala. Yes. From Guatemala. That makes sense because y'all are right next. We touch.
Yeah. The salvies and the guada. It's very similar tamales and lore.
Yes, and a lot of the same cuss words. But being Central American too, do you ever feel that folks are looking for you for representation and get upset when you're not filling that specific role of a Guatemalan that they might have in their own heads expected?
I know. I was mostly like raised with my mom's family. I don't know, it was like back and forth. My dad is Colombian, so it's a lot of like bicultural stuff that like wouldn't have happened if they weren't like displaced from their countries, if they didn't meet in an ASL class. I don't know, I'm ranting now, but I think like, I mean, I was just thinking like how excited I am that Oscar Isaac is Guatemalan and he is not necessarily doing like Guatemalan things. He's like he's like a white man in a sci-fi movie a lot, but I'm still like, yeah, like Chapin, like that's him. And I think it's because there's so few of us, like I think people might be just be excited. And I'm just going to try to be who I am, and people should just be like as specific as possible with their experiences.
And I think that's the beautiful thing too, is that I get excited to see folks from Central America and just that Latinos in general that are living their true authentic selves, you know? Like, I don't need you to all of a sudden start writing about conchas and tacos and stuff to consider part of, you know, something. And I find that refreshing, like, and I find that's what always has excited me about your work so much, that you're a writer who happens to be Colombian and Guatemalan, and you're not writing specifically from just that lens, because you are also someone that lives on the East Coast and someone that like a student and then that has gone on to be a writer and has done all of these things, and you bring all of that into your work, and it shows up even in this book and Dreaming of You. Like the fact that a non-Mexican is writing about Talina, I think it's dope, because it tends to not happen. And I just want to talk so much about like, but I don't want to give it away for people that haven't read it. Well, you know what? Fuck you. If you didn't read it. No, I'm kidding. But like the choices you made with Yolanda, with turning her into like a real person with and humanizing her and kind of like telling an imagined version of her version of the story. Like, what was like, how was that?
Yeah, I mean, I think there was a lot of different things that happened with Yolanda. When I started this, I like really wanted to have empathy for her. One of the first poems I wrote was, maybe spoiler, there's one called Yolanda Saldivar Breaks Out of Prison. But initially it was Yolanda Saldivar Gets Away With It. And it was this like alternate universe poem where Yolanda like just escapes the crime scene and then she walks off into the sunrise. And she kills a maid. She kills a maid and she takes her uniform. And like the woman who played Yolanda in the movie has played a maid over 100 times. And I was like, that's crazy that there's something there. So I play with that. And then I changed it to fit the story better. So now she breaks out of prison. She's such an interesting person, and she is like a person who is alive and has like autonomy, and I don't know how she thinks. I wanted to fictionalize, have this version of her where she gets another shot, and but we all have shots and we all have choices. That's all I'll say.
Yes, I loved it. And then there's also a love story in the middle of all of this, the you.
Yeah.
And I love how you don't know who the hell the you is. And then you change and all of that. And okay, wait. But sorry, like I'm a little like all over the place. This book started as something you were doing in grad school.
I started in grad school, yeah.
And it's evolved into an entire book.
Yeah, it was my thesis, and it was pretty like 85% like the same thing. And yeah, I was writing these like I just did this event with Terrence Hayes, my professor, and he was like pulling up my old poems. It was really embarrassing, but they were all stuff that like had to do with sex and celebrities and love and obsession and crushes. I just was like, let me investigate why do my love poems are so similar to my Selena poems? Like, there's this like desire there. There's this like, I'm putting somebody on a pedestal.
I just like digging through your brain, and I feel like I love how it moved. And for those of you that haven't read the book, there's also a reoccurring choir of chismosas that kind of narrates the story along, and I love that was borrowed from like Greek theater, right? Like,
yeah.
And so that's
really dope. Was. I mean, yeah. Talk yeah, about that's like one of my the chismosas. So they're this like all-encompassing. Like spirit who knows everything. Initially was me talking in retrospect, and that didn't make sense. And my agent was, you know, helping me put this book together, and she was like, this seems like you're a Greek chorus. And I was like, whoa, I have an idea. Let me make like, who are the choruses of my life? Like my sisters and my aunts and like, you know, family time, everyone's like fucking talking shit. So I wanted to do that, and I love them, and it is very like Greek like if you ever read Oedipus, which is about this guy who kills his mom and kills his father and fucks his mother, it's a very gossipy little story, but it's, you know, told by a Greek chorus. So yeah, I wanted that. It's a very weird book, but it's very traditional in many ways.
No, like, I mean, I think the weirdness of it, and I think when we use the word weird is not in a derogatory way, it's in a really refreshing way. I read, there's another book that I haven't felt what I felt with your book in a long time. And the last time that I felt it was with Miranda July's book, Nobody Belongs Here More Than You. Did you ever read that book?
Oh my God. Yes. Thank you for saying that. That's one of my favorite books.
That's one of my favorite books. And when I finished reading it, I said, they're very different books, but they made me feel the same way. Wherein, because you were so unashamed of your weirdness, your strange imagination and all of these, you bring it in so unapologetically and so like brilliantly that it allows the reader to like be like, yeah, I have weird things in me too. Like I'm a weirdo, you know? Miranda July's short stories have that in them, right? Like I'm haunted by the story of the black figure the woman has sex with.
That. I think about that all the time. That was a lot. That's really in this book, I think, that story. I don't know how, but it is.
I felt it. I felt a lot of that. I was so excited to tell you that. And I'm so glad that you've read the book and you understand what I mean.
Oh, yeah. Like, you knew.
It unlocked the same things.
Yeah. Making Love in 2003, that book. That's that story.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Now you guys, y'all have more homework. You have to read Dreaming of You first, and then you have to read Hermosa, and then you have to read Nobody Belongs Here More Than You by Miranda July. And and if you can't find it, order it through Duende, because that's how we support them. Okay, so now we're going to talk about the poet you, right? Like, and the professional you. What is your dream for your baby? Like, I call my books my children, and I'm sure that you do too. And whenever, you know, we hear mothers talk about what they would like to see their children grow up and become in the world. And what is your dreaming of you? Like, what are you wanting to see her? How do you want to see her move in this world?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's still in this really beautiful stage of people. Like, I want to see people put, like, I'm seeing people post pictures of poems and like, it's really, it's like, it means so much to me. I can't even explain it. And like seeing it, like just seeing it places, and it's just like lived on this laptop that I'm talking to you on right now. And that is amazing. I want to see this book become a movie somehow, and I'm working on whatever that looks like. And that's been weird and fun, and it's like learning a new way of writing a poem, because it's like a whole different like style.
That's so cool. Oh my god, the movie.
I love it.
And like, and I think I'm not gonna ask you what's next, because I feel like I'm like, we get asked that when we're like promoting something we just released.
I know.
You know, you'll be like, you're promoting your book, and like, so what's next? And you're like, can I breathe?
But I mean, like, I got plans, but
what are you dreaming for yourself next? What would be your what's that?
I'm writing some short stories. I have an idea for a book. The short stories have been really fun. Honestly, ever since I read No One Belongs Here More Than You, I was like, I want to write short stories, and I want to like have this like feeling. I want to give someone this feeling after I've like written something. And I don't know. I want to fall in love. That sounds great.
Yes. You know what? I'm excited to hear that you're writing short stories. And my cousin's daughter asked me for books for her birthday. She's turning 14 on Saturday, but her family is very religious. They're like evangelical, which is not a bad thing. They have taken it a little, like they've just gone off like the deep end with it. But I was very calculated about the books I gave her, and yours was one of them. And I know that she's 14, and it's still a very horny book, but I don't think anybody's hornier than 14-year-olds. So. Yeah, so I'm like, it'll make sense when it is. And then I gave her a couple of other books that I feel are important. But I know that there's always the books that we read that, like, we might not completely understand, but we know it stirred something in us. And I really think that that's what Dreaming of You is. And I pray that your dreams come true, and especially you falling in love, because I know that that will fuel.
Yeah.
What more poems you say?
Yes. Yeah.
And I know we're friends and we're peers, but I am a genuine fan of yours, Melissa, from your Twitter to your writing to you as a person. And it sucks that we don't get to spend that much time with each other, but eventually we will do a show together.
It'll be incredible. Yeah, Yesika, you're such a dream. Yeah.
Yeah, I love you so much. And I'm going to let you go because you're gonna sing now.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm going to watch.
All right, here we go.
All right. Thank you so much
for having me. I'm going to hang out and watch the scene, but thank you so much for having me. Melissa, this book is it's the best book I've read this year. And I'm not even saying that because I'm here. Like, it genuinely is the best book I read. Those are my friends that release books that are watching. I love your books too, but I love Melissa's more. And thank you so much, Zonde, and the word for having me. And I'm going to hand it over.
Yesika. Oh, thank you, Yesika. Oh, we love you. We love you so much. Such huge fans. Forever. Okay. All right, Melissa.
All right. What do you
say? Since grad school in 2009. Okay.
Wow.
and just, like, for everybody to know, trying to sing Selena is no joke. So I will mess this up.
I will too. I'm going to. The Spanish is hard.
Like, the Spanish is so hard. I was like, no, goodness to God, because that's like, I've heard that a million times, and then I try. It's like the choruses are fine, but it's just okay. So this will be fun. I'm gonna dedicate my terrible rendition of this to Danny. Danny Vasquez is Melissa's editor. I have like a bestseller crush on him. Because he's hilarious and also wants to punch publishing in the face. And I'm like,
I know. That's why I trust him.
I know, right? I'm horny for your editor, is what I'm trying to say.
Are you watching this?
Well, if he is, Danny, well, guess what? I'm horny for you wanting to punch publishing in the face. Yes. Okay. All right. We're going to. Hopefully this won't be too loud and I won't make too much of a fool of myself. All right, here we go. Let me adjust my sound so it's not okay. All right. Hopefully everybody can hear that. Melissa, can you hear that?
I can hear. Okay. I cannot hear it.
You can't hear it?
No.
Wait. No?
No.
Let me turn it up. Boop. How's that?
I can hear.
You can hear? Okay.
Yeah.
I'll try to sing over. Cariño, ya basta tu juego. Pues yo no soy ningún juguete. Amigo, oh, esto no es justo. Y no estoy para recibirte. Se te estás difícil con mi hermoso siempre jugar. Pero muy pronto yo tengo pongar en tu lugar. No debes jugar con mi amor. No debes jugar con mi cariño. Si me quieres o no, ya dímelo. Para seguir ya mi camino. Cariño, sabes que te quiero. Y por mi parte, verdad de toro. Amigo, no soy una maniaca que las te acuerde cuando quieres. Pienso que todas están quietas, ¿sí o no? A ver lo que dirás cuando te diga adiós. No debes jugar con mi amor. No debes jugar con mi cariño. Si me quieres o no, ya dímelo. Para seguir ya mi camino. No debes jugar con mi amor. No debes jugar con mi cariño. Si me quieres o no, ya dímelo. Para seguir ya mi camino. I don't know if you heard any of that. Yeah. You will be perfect after me.
That was amazing. Yay. That was incredible.
All right, Melissa, your turn.
Can I share my screen? Will that work?
I think you. Oh yes, you can. Oh, I was supposed to share my screen. I completely forgot.
Oh, you're right.
But yes, you can share your screen. If you go to go down at the bottom, you'll see like the little thing.
Okay.
And it'll be sharing a share plus.
Can people see this? Okay. Is that working? Are you seeing me share the screen?
We see you, but have you brought up your
I did.
You hit the little share button.
Hit the share button. Okay, share screen. I'm gonna do that. And okay, I'm pulling this up. I don't know if this is working or not.
Yep, there it goes.
You can see it?
You are okay, great. You can see it.
Okay. All right. All right, I'm singing into this Pepto-Bismol.
Time.
ese error es cosa de okay.
Amazing. You are amazing. Promise me the next time we see each other, we'll go drinking and karaoke.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Melissa. You are the best. I love this book. I love this book, you guys. Hold on. Like, seriously? I agree with Yesika. It is the best book I've read all year. Oh, y'all need to get it. Read it. Get Hermosa. Get all of Yesika's books too. Get Paluda. I got the whole thing here. Yes. Like, hold on. Let me get it. Here we are. That's what you want.
Yellow and red.
And you want Hermosa. My Yesika books didn't come, which bugged me. And I was like, because I like to have a little show and tell.
All right. Beso. Thank you for having me. Yeah. Take care.
Bye. Love you. Love the word. Thank you, everybody. You are amazing.
Thank you.
We do have a couple events in December coming up, so we'll have info about that soon.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for joining tonight. And remember, you can buy the books at duendedistrict.com. Follow the word and Duende on our socials to stay up to date on all our upcoming events. And thank you all so much. Thanks, Angela. I'll see you soon.
Thank you, Ida. I'll see you soon. Bye. Have a good one.
You too.